If you've been a viewer of this channel since the beginning, then you'll probably have seen my various ramblings and rantings on the apparently thorny subject of hydrogen. Don't get me wrong, I like hydrogen a lot. We wouldn't be here without it, of course, seeing as how it's the element that's been keeping our star burning for the last 4.6 billion years or so, and will keep it glowing brightly for another 5 billion. It also has all sorts of useful applications here on Earth, among other things as a feedstock for various chemicals like methanol, as part of hydrogenation processes to convert unsaturated hydrocarbons into saturated hydrocarbons in the production of edible oils, as a reducing agent in steel making, and of course to produce the ammonia that forms a key part of the fertilizers that make our current food growing practices possible. But setting fire to it to heat your home and cook your food? Meh, maybe not so much. Hello, and welcome to Just Have a Think. When it comes to hydrogen, there are plenty of people far more experienced and knowledgeable than me who've waded into the debate about whether the lightest element in the universe can play any meaningful role in the direct replacement of fossil fuels. One of those people is Michael Liebreich, who spent many years researching the appropriate uses for H2 and has produced the now very well publicised hydrogen ladder, outlining all proposed applications ranging from essential stuff right on the top rung, all the way down to fanciful folly at the bottom. And you'll notice that right down there on this so-called uncompetitive rung, we have domestic heating. So why is that then? After all, we've all heard about various trials of hydrogen for home heating and possibly even cooking, haven't we? Most of them sponsored by the incumbent gas network operators, by the way. And that kind of gives us a clue as to the possible motivation behind such proposals. If we can keep the existing vast networks of gas pipelines, so the argument goes, then surely we can just pump hydrogen through those pipes instead of methane gas, and hey presto, we've got a carbon-free drop-in replacement, and we've solved the climate emergency in one fell swoop. Which brings me nicely to a second leading figure in the hydrogen debate, a chemical engineer from Toronto, Canada, by the name of Paul Martin. Full disclosure here, Paul is a friend of the channel, and someone with whom I've discussed the ins and outs of hydrogen several times over recent years. He spent about 30 years designing, building and testing pilot, demonstration and first commercial plants in the petrochemical industry, specialising in the use of hydrogen as a process chemical and really delving into the nuts and bolts of engineering challenges across hundreds of projects. So he knows his onions when it comes to hydrogen. And along with a group of similarly learned colleagues, he recently published this peer-reviewed paper outlining the challenges of converting an existing natural gas system over to hydrogen.
It takes 3 liters of hydrogen to produce the same amount of heat as 1 liter of methane. To move a gas down a pipe, you have to compress the gas. That's where the energy to overcome the friction of the gas flowing down the pipe comes from, compressors. And if you have to compress 3 liters of gas, irrespective of its density, instead of compressing a liter of another gas, that takes 3 times as much energy. So the problem that you have when you try to repurpose a pipe of a given size for a different commodity is that it's not economic to move hydrogen at 3 times the velocity. So in fact, what you would do is you would never do that. You would derate the pipe's carrying capacity. So instead of delivering 1,000 joules a minute of natural gas, you'd have it deliver 300 or 400 or 500 joules a minute of hydrogen.
But hang on, say the proponents of hydrogen. Those are all big engineering challenges for sure, but if we can avoid the greenhouse gas emissions from the combustion of fossil fuels by burning hydrogen instead, then it must surely be worth all the additional effort, right? Well, there's a bit more bad news there as well, I'm afraid. Let's start with the way that most hydrogen is currently produced.
So first of all, hydrogen today is made from methane and coal, largely, and it's also made a little bit from petroleum, and it's made for use for its unique properties as a chemical. And almost nobody burns it on purpose. So we don't waste it as a fuel because it's made from a fuel. And 99% of the hydrogen in the world is made from fossils, and the CO2 is just dumped to the atmosphere. And in the process of making it, you lose energy. So if you put in 1 joule of energy in the form of natural gas into a steam methane reformer, you might get 0.7 joules worth of hydrogen out of it. but you get all 1 joule's worth of CO2 in the atmosphere, plus all the methane leakage and all the other bad stuff. So this is what I call the decarbonization problem of hydrogen, which is a problem that must be solved because its emissions, the CO2 and methane emissions associated with hydrogen production, are actually greater than those of the whole aviation industry right now. Now, when we're talking about futures, people are talking about futures, dreamland futures, I would say, without economic basis, where we're going to be taking electricity and using it to break water apart into hydrogen and oxygen, and then we're going to be shipping that hydrogen around and then using it for purposes of energy, like using it as a fuel for vehicles or heating or the like. And I think those aren't really fantasies. They're more nightmares because they're super expensive and not very practical. And unfortunately, the hope around those sorts of futures is being used to delay real decarbonization, which, you know, if you ask a smart engineer about it, they're going to say, well, the obvious thing to do instead is to use the electricity to do whatever you were going to do with the hydrogen, as the electricity will do it more efficiently and at lower cost.
But the main issue with hydrogen in gas networks is really one of practicality. Methane gas is typically distributed via very long transmission pipelines or liquefied to be sent across oceans.
What actually happens is in a pipeline that's made out of strong steels that are hard, the pipeline flexes, it gets a little bit bigger when you put higher pressure into it, and then it shrinks back down again when the pressure drops again. And that happens every day as people are using gas, and sometimes several times a day. And that causes fatigue. The trouble with hydrogen is it gets into the metal matrix and it causes fatigue cracks to grow much faster. It prevents the healing that used to happen. So two microscopic parts of metal separate, and hydrogen gets in between them and prevents them from sticking together again. And it acts kind of as a propant that causes the crack to grow. You know, it's just like, well, a dangerous thing to put in your gas network if you value your pipe, because soon it will be cracked and leaking, and that would be bad.
When natural gas arrives in our towns and cities, it gets delivered to you and me via a network of low to medium pressure underground pipes made of a range of materials, including mild steel, cast iron, and high density polyethylene, or HDPE. Hydrogen molecules can get through HDPE quite easily. They can also leak through other soft areas like gaskets and seals. So that's not ideal, is it? Research suggests that the leakage rate of hydrogen through plastic pipes could be as much as 4 to 5 times higher than methane, depending on flow rates and local conditions. At the point where the pipeline reaches our homes, network operators would have to replace every domestic gas meter with new equipment to measure volumetric flows that would need to be about 3 times higher to deliver the same energy content. Those new meters would also have to eliminate the large elastomeric or polymeric components used in existing diaphragm-type meters that have been known to underreport flow rate when fed gas mixtures containing hydrogen. Then there's storage. Remember those big old gasometers that we used to have on the edges of our urban conurbations when town gas was widely used? You know, the ones that used to go up and down all the time. They were there to take up the slack in supply and demand. These days, that slack is predominantly taken up by the pressurized gas sitting in the pipeline network itself. It's called line pack, and it serves as a vital tool for maintaining operational stability. Switching to hydrogen with only 1/3 the volumetric energy density would reduce that line pack insurance to only 1/3 of its current level. In colder climates, where much more gas is needed for heating in the winter, large volumes of hydrogen would therefore have to be stored somewhere else. Salt caverns are a possibility, but we haven't exactly got one of those on every street corner, have we? And constructing new ones would be incredibly expensive.
In order for the salt cavern to have any storage, you have to have the pressure go up and down, which means all the pipes that go to and from it will have it's their pressure going up and down, and the flow going first one direction and then the other, which makes all of this fatigue business even worse. So storage, the salt cavern storage, and this notion of seasonal storage is largely an economic myth.
But let's assume all of those challenges were overcome. What about the appliances in our homes? We've all been reassured by the gas boiler manufacturers that all their new models will be hydrogen ready. So that's encouraging, right?
You have to replace the end-use devices. It's not a simple matter. Listeners might be familiar with, for instance, buying a, an appliance that's meant for natural gas, and then they switch to LPG, you know, to propane or the like, and all they have to do is replace a little nozzle in the appliance, and it works fine again. Well, that's not the case with hydrogen, because the properties are completely different. For one thing, hydrogen burns with a flame that's not visible during the day. The rate at which a flame propagates, so when you ignite a gas mixture and the flame moves along, it's 8 times faster for hydrogen than it is for methane. So that causes problems with the buildup of pressure that happens if you happen to have a release and then there's an ignition and you have get what they call a deflagration, a really fast fire that doesn't generate a devastating supersonic shockwave like an explosive would, but still you get a bad, you know, you release hydrogen in your home and then somebody turns on a light switch and that ignites the hydrogen. That's way worse than filling your room with methane. Even though the methane has a higher energy density per unit volume, there's a much wider range between the minimum concentration where you can start a fire called the lower explosive limit and the maximum concentration where there's more fuel than air and it can ignite, the upper explosive limit. The range between those two things for hydrogen is the widest of basically any chemical. For methane, the range is between 5 and about 16 or 18% in air is ignitable, and above 18, it's not, and below 5, it's not. And with hydrogen, it's between 4 and 75%. So it's a huge range. Basically, if you have a hydrogen leak and there's a source of ignition, which there always is, you will have a deflagration, and it'll be bad.
Now, it's hardly surprising that existing gas network operators are extremely keen for us to transition over to hydrogen in our homes, rather than simply using electricity to run energy-efficient devices like induction hobs and heat pumps. After all, they own an extremely expensive piece of infrastructure, and they don't want to see it made redundant. But if I could offer my own two penneth for a moment, that view surely catastrophically misses the point, doesn't it? Surely the objective here is to minimise greenhouse gas emissions, not protect the profits of industry incumbents who find themselves under threat from much better, more environmentally friendly market-disrupting alternatives.
And so you have to make some assumptions about what hydrogen could cost in the future. So if we take the dreamy future where hydrogen, green hydrogen made from electricity gets very, very cheap and drops to $3 per kilogram. When you run the calculations, it's very, very much more expensive than $3. And I think getting to $3 will be very, very challenging and only possible in certain parts of the world. At $3 a kilogram, hydrogen used to displace natural gas costs $350 per ton of CO2 emissions averted. And at $350 per ton of CO2 emissions averted, I can do all sorts of things to eliminate CO2 emissions that are far more practical and sensible and quicker. And of course, the $3 a kilogram thing is saying my cost of production is $3 a kilogram and my cost of distribution is zero. So you have to pay a delivery charge because you have to pay for those pipes and their maintenance and the compressors and the energy to run them and all those things. I haven't included that. So if you include that, it's probably $700 a ton. That's what's really going on here. It's a predatory delay strategy. It's not really about decarbonization at all, right? We take energy for granted and greenhouse gas emissions are something that happens and we know is bad, but we generate them anyway and we kind of go about our lives without thinking about it too much. And I get it. But at the same time, you know, the public policy people that are thinking about this stuff are not thinking about it carefully. And they don't want to have the hard conversation with people and say, look, you want to build a new house? We're not going to let you have a natural gas connection. Sorry. Why get you addicted to this thing that we're going to have to replace later? So that's a logical first step that we should be taking. And we're already seeing howls of protest where that's happening. That's why we wrote our paper. We want people to make those decisions on the basis of good, sound, disinterested scientific and technical information.
No doubt you've got your own views on this hot topic. So as always, if you're feeling a burning desire to express your opinion, then jump down to the comment section below to leave your thoughts there. That's it for this week though. Thanks as always to the folks who support the channel via Patreon. I never monetize any of my videos on YouTube or take paid sponsorships, so So this channel would not exist without that amazing group of like-minded people all over the world supporting the work I do each week. If you'd like to join them and discover the exclusive perks you can enjoy at my Patreon page, then jump over to patreon.com/justeverthink. And if you found this video useful and informative, then you can hugely support me absolutely for free by hitting the like and subscribe buttons on YouTube and clicking on all notifications. It doesn't cost a penny to do that, and it's just a simple click away, either down there or on that icon there. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.